Can you tell us a bit about your childhood before you left Czechoslovakia?
Well, I had a very, very normal childhood. First of all, when I was very small, we lived in a little village, which was in Moravia. And when I was 7 years old, we moved to Prague. And really, it was quite normal. I went to school. I used to attend, although we're Jewish, I attended the local school. And it was mostly a Catholic school, but that was fine, because I don't think there was even a synagogue, you know, in this little village. And I was not brought up in the faith. But of course, none of that made any difference until the war began.
Can you tell us why you had to leave?
This is quite difficult, because the reason I was leaving was, we think, was the reason that my father was warned to leave just before the Germans invaded. And my father was warned by the Czech underground, not because he was Jewish, which he was, but because he was implicated politically with a very famous German writer called Thomas Mann. Thomas Mann had written a lot of anti-Nazi articles. Some of his books were really anti-Nazi, and he was made stateless. He was living in Switzerland, and that meant his passport had been taken away. And my father was a very great admirer of his writing. So he suggested to our own little village where we lived that they made him an honorary citizen of the village, of the little town. But to do that, he needed permission from the Czech president. And so they went to Prague, they saw the president, and the president sent my father to Switzerland to offer Thomas Mann and his family Czech citizenship, Czech passport, which he very happily accepted. And in 1937 he came to visit the town to thank them, and then with the passport he went to America. But because of what my father had done, the night before the Germans invaded, on the 15th of March, they'd already occupied the Sudetenland area, which was the border area of the Czech Republic. My father was warned to leave the country.
Could you tell us what the special transport was like, and how did you feel?
Well, these trains were organised, which we discovered 40 years later, by a gentleman called Nicky Winton. But when I was told in May that I was going to go to England, I was nine and a half, and I had a sister who was 3 and a half. And at that time, it seemed more like an adventure. We knew that my father was in England, but all I really remember of it is that, first of all, I had to learn a little bit of English, and I learned the national anthem, God Save Our Gracious King, at the time it was. And then on July the 31st, we were taken to the railway station. My memory of that is very, very hazy, I have to admit. What I do remember was that we only had our rucksacks with us, our backpacks, because our cases had been taken away and put into the luggage, where the luggage was. In the backpacks, we had to have enough food for the 24 hours that it was going to take us to get to Holland. My little sister was very quiet, she didn't cry. And we set off throughout the journey, although the train stopped. It was a normal train, but we weren't allowed to get out of our carriage. The carriage was locked, and we were in our compartments. And when we got to Holland, that was the first time we were able to leave, because by that point the Holland wasn't occupied. So the whole journey is very vague, except I did meet a friend who sat in the same carriage with me, and she said, you know, when we were there, we held hands, and as the train set off, we said that we're not going to cry. And that's really my only memory of the journey.
How did you settle into your new life in England? Was it very difficult for you?
We couldn't speak English, you're quite right. And, you know, at that age, you really learn a language very quickly. If nobody else speaks Czech, you know, you very quickly learn another language. And by 1940, my English was fine, my spelling was okay, my arithmetic was very bad, my singing was good. So by that time I was speaking fluent English. But because my father was in England, and I'd forgotten to say that by 1940 my mother also escaped. We were very lucky. We were one of the few children whose parents actually managed to escape, because most of those children on those trains lost their parents. And then in 1942, the Czech government in exile set up a school, a refugee school for Czech children. And so my father decided that he would send me away to this Czech school so that I wouldn't forget my language. But my mother wouldn't let my little sister go. She said no, she'd sent her away once, you know. And she nearly forgot her Czech. By the time my mother came, we'd been living with the English family, she nearly forgot it. But what was interesting, the family had a daughter called Mary, and because they only had two bedrooms, they sent Mary to live with the grandmother to make space for us.
How did you rebuild your life after the war?
Well, during the war, of course, I went to this Czech boarding school. Sounds very posh, but actually it was an old decrepit manor house that was falling apart. We must have been about 120 children, and then we were moved to Wales, to a little village called Llanoted Wells, right in the middle of the Brecon Hills. And when the school finished in 1945, all those children, there were one or two like me who had parents here, returned. They returned and found no one, as my grandparents and my cousins, their parents, they'd all been taken away to concentration camps and died. And we were very lucky. We stayed in England. And I had finished the school. By that time I was 16, and I had to go to work. So I started training as a nursery nurse and worked in the local day nurseries. And then I worked in a children's home for 2 years near Lancaster. And then I decided I wanted to learn French. So I put an advert in a French newspaper and went over as an au pair to France, came back. And soon after that, I met the man that I eventually married.
What was it that Nicholas Winton actually did?
Well, if you want to sit here for the next 4 hours, I can tell you the long story. But what actually happened, Nicholas Winton was going on a skiing holiday in 1938. It was November, by which time the Czech Republic had been invaded in the Sudetenland, and a lot of Jewish people had been thrown out of their homes, and they had nowhere else to go, but they were around Prague. There were 200,000 Czech Jewish refugees sitting around Prague because they'd been thrown out of their own homes because they lived in the part that the Germans had already invaded. And there was a group of people trying to rescue some of them, but they were really asked to rescue the people who were at the most danger, people like writers, politicians. And there was no one coping with the children because some of the parents were desperate to get their children away. And Nicholas Winton had a friend in Prague who wrote to him and said, look, don't go on holiday, come to Prague. We really need someone who could organize and help us with the children. So this is exactly, he was 29. He was a stockbroker. He came to Prague, and he could see that somebody had to do something about, or because everything was in chaos. And so he set up an office in a hotel, and within 2 days, there were 2,000 people trying to get to him to see whether he could get their children to England. And all he could do was take their names. And he stayed in Prague for 3 weeks, and he made lists of names, because what he then had to do was to come back to England and find families who would have the children. Because by then, they didn't think there'd be a war. No countries would accept refugee children anymore. And so he came back, and in the afternoons when he finished work with his mother, he set up an office and started advertising in newspapers, in magazines, looking for families who would take children. And as soon as he had some family who said, yes, we will, he was then able to send a message to Prague and say, I've got 10 families, put 10 children on the train. And these children were brought over. And this way he managed to do 7 trains with different numbers of children. And he says his saddest thing was that the last train that had 200 children, he'd found 200 more families, that train never left because war broke out. And from that train, we know only 4 survived. So this is really, people say, why did he do it? He said he did it because he saw that somebody had to do something to help, that you did not stand by and just watch what was going on or do nothing. But there's a book that's been written about him called If It's Not Impossible. And that was basically his saying, if it's not impossible, you get on and you do it.
When was the first time you met Nicholas Winton and how did you feel?
My goodness, yes, the first time we met Nicholas Winton. Well, one day I was in the kitchen and the telephone rang and I answered the phone and this lady said, this is Esther Ranson. And I knew that Esther Ranson was a very famous television lady who had a program called That's Life on a Sunday night. And because this voice said, this is Esther Ranson, I said, and I'm the Queen of England, because I did not believe it was Esther Ranson phoning me. I thought somebody was really having a joke. She said, no, she said, what was your name before you were married? And I said, it was Milena Fleischmann. She said, well, I'd like you to come down to the studio because we've got this gentleman called Nicholas Winton. I'm talking about 1988 now. And still, none of us knew how we'd got on those trains. And when we got to the studio, she said, now, we're going to bring this Mr. Winton in, but we don't want him to know who you are. So when they brought this gentleman in and he sat between us, she had a scrapbook that she'd got hold of because she'd already found him. And she had this scrapbook. And she said, now, Mr. Winton, we want to talk about your scrapbook. And she opened pages and she found some photographs and she said, and on your left is Vera Gissing, who's this little girl in your photograph book, and on your right is me. And of course he got a total shock. He had no idea he was going to be meeting us. And that was the first time we met the man who saved our lives. And the following week, she asked him to come again. And then when she said, well, those people who were on the train, stand up, that most of the studio stood up, because by that point about 100 odd people had saw the programme, realised who he was and got in touch. Also wrote a little saying, it's no good you being good by not being bad. Really, if you've got any sense and you see that anyone's in trouble, you try and help them. And it's as simple as that.